أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد والثناء لله رب العالمين ثم الصلاة والسلام على خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين ولعنة الله على أعدائهم ومنكر فضائلهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. السلام عليكم dear brothers and sisters ورحمة الله وبركاته. First and foremost, I'd like to extend my warmest congratulations to all of you on the occasion of the birth of Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam. And inshallah, before we begin the tafsir for tonight, I'd like to just share with you a couple of traditions relating to Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam. There's a hadith from Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari, the prominent and distinguished companion of the Holy Prophet. He says, one day I was sitting with Rasulullah, and he said to me, Ya Jabir, yushaku an tabqa hatta talqa waladan min wuldi. Ismuhu ismi, O Jabir, you will live a long life, and you will live such a long life that you will meet one of my sons from my descendants whose name is my name. Yuqalu lahu Muhammad ibn Ali ibn al-Husayn. He will be Muhammad, son of Ali, son of Husayn, my grandson. Then Rasulullah says, Yabqur al-ilma baqara. Rasulullah says, this son of mine, whose name is Muhammad, he will split open the reservoirs of knowledge. You see that this title of Baqir was assigned to the Imam by the Holy Prophet. And then Rasulullah says to him, فَإِذَا رَأَيْتَهُ فَقَرَأْهُ مِنِّ السَّلَامِ O Jabir, when you meet him, I want you to convey my salam to him. And the traditions say that many, many years after the death of the Holy Prophet, almost four decades after the death of the Holy Prophet, Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari was in the city of Medina, and he had become blind at the time. And he heard footsteps that reminded him of the footsteps of Rasulullah. You see that even the way Imam al-Baqir used to walk was resembling the Holy Prophet. So Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari greets Imam al-Baqir and he says to him that your grandfather Rasulullah conveys his salam to you. And the Imam alayhi salam responds by saying, wa ala jadd al-salam wa alayka al-salam ya Jabir. There's a very beautiful hadith from Imam al-Baqir that I believe that all of us can benefit from and we can apply in our daily lives. And it's a hadith about our responsibility to our parents. Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam, he says, إِنَّ الْعَبْدَ لَيَكُونُ بَارًا بِوَالِدَيْهِ فِي حَيَاتِهِمَا ثُمَّ يَمُوتَان فَلَا يَقْضِ عَنْهُمَا دَيْنَهُمَا وَلَا يَسْتَغْفِرْ لَهُمَا فَيَكْتُبُهُ اللَّهُ عَاقًا. The Imam alayhi salam, he says, it could be that a person is dutiful to his parents during their lifetime, but after they pass away, he doesn't pay off their debts and he doesn't do istighfar for them, and Allah will record him among the insolent ones to his parents. And then the Imam says, وَإِنَّهُ لَيَكُونُ عَاقًا لَهُمَا فِي حَيَاتِهِمَا غَيْرَ بَارٍ بِهِمَا فَإِذَا مَاتَ قَضَى دَيْنَهُمَا وَاسْتَغْفَرَ لَهُمَا فَيَكْتُبُهُ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلْ بَارًا. And the Imam says, conversely, there may be someone who mistreated his parents during their lifetime. He wasn't dutiful to them. He wasn't good to them. But after they passed away, he paid off their debts. He maybe recited prayers for them. He seeks forgiveness on their behalf. And because of that, on the day of Qiyamah, he will be considered among those who were dutiful to his parents. So this hadith from Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam is a very important reminder that when we speak about being good to our parents, some may listen to a lecture about birrul walidain, about being good and dutiful to the parents, but they may say this lecture doesn't apply to me because my parents passed away a long time ago. Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam, he teaches us that our responsibility to our parents continues even after they pass away. So if it's been a long time since you've remembered your parents, if your parents have passed away and you don't remember them in dua, you don't seek istighfar for them, you don't do good deeds upon on their behalf, you have to be very careful, because perhaps Allah Azza wa Jal may record you among those who didn't do justice to their parents. Inshallah, tonight we're going to continue with the tafsir of Surah Al-An'am. And with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's grace, we reached ayah number 14. And there was a request to try to cover more verses of the Holy Quran in each session. I will do my best. I definitely don't want to give you a watered-down version of the tafsir. So inshallah, I'll do my best to cover a little bit more ground. And inshallah, in the subsequent sessions, we'll try to cover more and more ayat so we can finish the surah in a timely fashion. I draw your attention, brothers and sisters, to ayah number 14 of Surah Al-An'am. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. قُلْ أَغَيْرَ اللَّهِ أَتَّخِذُ وَلِيًّا فَاطِرِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَهُوَ يُطْعِمُ وَلَا يُطْعَمُ قُلْ إِنِّي أُمِرْتُ أَنْ أَكُونَ أَوَّلَ مَنْ أَسْلَمُ وَلَا تَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. The translation reads, say, O Muhammad, shall I take as a protector anyone other than Allah, the originator of the heavens and the earth, who feeds and is not fed? Say, O Muhammad, I was commanded to be the first of those who submit and be not among the polytheists. If you remember, my dear brothers and sisters, we mentioned that Surah Al-An'am was revealed at one time in its totality to the Holy Prophet, meaning that it was not revealed bit by bit as we find with other surahs. Some of the Mufassirin of the Holy Quran, they mentioned that these verses were revealed as a response to an offer that was made to the Holy Prophet. Now, the entire surah was revealed at once, but this verse in particular was revealed as a response, as a reply to an offer that was made to the Holy Prophet by the Mushrikeen. The Mushrikeen of Mecca, when they saw that the Holy Prophet was serious about this mission and he was attracting many people to his message, they made an offer to him. They said to him, Ya Muhammad, innaka tarakta deena qawmik. O Muhammad, you have abandoned the religious tradition of your people, the religious tradition of idol worship. وَلَمْ يَكُنْ ذَٰلِكَ إِلَّا بِسَبَبِ فَقْرِكَ. Here they accuse the Holy Prophet of creating and inventing this new religion because of poverty. They said that you invented this religion because you're poor. You're trying to introduce this faith in hopes of attaining and acquiring wealth, amassing wealth. فَقْبَلْ مِنَّا نِصْفَ أَمْوَالِنَا. O Muhammad, accept this wealth that we offer you, half of what we possess. تَكُنْ غَنِيًا. We will take care of you. We will give you wealth, so we will alleviate any financial strain that you may have. عَلَىٰ أَن تَتْرُكَ آلِهَتَنَا وَشَأْنَهَا وَتَعُودَ إِلَىٰ دِينِكَ. They say to the Prophet basically that, listen, you're poor. We'll give you money, we'll take care of you, we'll cover all of your expenses if you abandon this mission and if you refrain from speaking out against our idols. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here tells the Prophet, قُلْ, say to them, O Muhammad, أَغَيْرَ اللَّهِ أَتَّخِذُ وَلِيًّا. Shall I take as a protector anyone other than Allah? Here the word wali is used. One of the 99 names of Allah Azza wa Jal is al-wali. Now here, wali is translated as protector. But unfortunately, there is no single word in the English language that captures the meaning, the complete meaning of wali. In the Arabic language, brothers and sisters, a wali refers to someone who is your caretaker, your protector, someone who looks after all of your affairs. In the same way, for example, in the Sharia, the father and the paternal grandfather have wilaya over the children, meaning no decision can be made without consulting with them. They are the maintainers, the caretakers, the providers of the children. So here, the mushrikeen are basically making an offer to the Prophet that we will take care of you. We will provide for you what you need if you turn away from propagating this message. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds the Holy Prophet and he reminds the mushrikeen that I am the only one who is a true wali. I am the one who is your provider, your caretaker, the one who sustains you, the one who looks after all of your affairs. In fact, wali refers to a caretaker and a sustainer and a provider who is close to you. You may have someone who cares for you and provides for you, but they're not close to you. There's no nearness. Here, wali conveys the meaning of closeness, nearness, someone who protects you, someone who provides for you, someone who maintains you, who fulfills all of your needs. And you find that in Surah Yusuf, Nabi Yusuf alayhi salam, he has a beautiful statement at the end of Surah Yusuf. If you go to Surah Yusuf, Surah number 12, ayah number 101. Nabi Yusuf alayhi salam, he refers to this wilaya that Allah has over him. He says, Rabbi qad ataytani min al-mulk. Oh Allah, you have given me some of the kingdom. وَعَلَّمْتَنِي مِن تَأْوِيلِ الْأَحَادِيثِ. And oh Allah, you have taught me the interpretation of dreams. فَاطِرِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. You are the originator of the heavens and the earth. So here Yusuf is referring to the fact that it is Allah who gave him power over Egypt. He gave him dominion. He gave him this kingdom and this authority. And he is the one who taught him the interpretation of dreams. And he is the one who brought the entire universe into being. Anta wali fi dunya wal akhirah. Yusuf alayhi salam, he says, oh Allah, you are my wali in this life. You are the one who cares for me, who provides for me, who teaches me, who nurtures me in this life and in the akhirah. Anta wali fi dunya wal akhirah. Tawaffani musliman. Here you find Yusuf alayhi salam, a prophet of God, who is concerned about his aqibah. He says, oh Allah, make me die as someone who is submissive to you. Brothers and sisters, you see how important it is to have a good end, husnul aqibah. You see anbiya, they're making dua that Allah takes their souls when they are in a state of submission to him. تَوَفَّنِي مُسْلِمًا وَأَلْحِقْنِي بِالصَّالِحِينَ. So here the ayah, going back to ayah number 14, قُلْ أَغَيْرَ اللَّهِ أَتَّخِذُ وَلِيًّا. Is there anyone else who qualifies to be my wali other than Allah? فَاطِرِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. In some verses in the Quran, you find that the verb خَلَقَ is used. Many verses in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to himself as الَّذِي خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Here, the verb فَطَرَ is used. Now, the word فَطَرَ means شَقَّ. It means to split something open. Now, why does the Quran use the word فَطَرَ? Now, as I said, if you take something and you split it open, this is called fatara. And perhaps for a long time, many people did not understand what Allah Azza wa Jal meant when he said, fatara samawati wal ardh. But now with recent findings in astronomy and physics, we know that the universe is approximately 15 to 20 billion years old. And scientists in the 19th or 20th century, they discovered that this universe that we see, this vast universe, is actually expanding. At every moment, the universe, the cosmos, is expanding. And if it's expanding, that means if you reverse the hands of time, the universe would shrink and shrink and shrink until it reaches zero volume, which means it reaches one single point. We know that the universe originally was one single mass, and then it exploded into existence. That there was a big bang that took place, and all of the galaxies and the planets and the stars emerged from that celestial blast. You find that essentially, if you look at Surah Al-Anbiya, Surah number 21, Ayah number 30, this will give us some clarity on the issue of fatara samawati wal ard. Allah in Surah Al-Anbiya, verse 30, He says, أَوَلَمْ يَرَى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَنَّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ كَانَتَا رَتْقًا فَفَتَقْنَاهُمَا. Do the disbelievers not see that the heavens and the earth, the universe, was a single mass? It was one single mass, and I split it open. فَفَتَقْنَاهُمَا. I rent it asunder. So you find that not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't just bring the universe into being. فَطَرَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ gives us a glimpse into how He created the universe. It was a single mass, and He split it. And from that big bang or that blast, all of the galaxies and the stars and the planets came into being. قُلْ أَغَيْرَ اللَّهِ أَتَّخِذُ وَلِيًّا فَاطِرِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَهُوَ يُطْعِمُ وَلَا يُطْعَمُ. Here, this part of the ayah is describing Allah. It says, who feeds, the one who originated the heavens and the earth, He feeds but is not fed. This, brothers and sisters, is a reference to Allah's complete independence from His creation. Everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created is in need of some type of nourishment. It has dependency. And you find that all of the birds and the animals and the plants, what do they need? They need food. They need some type of nourishment. Allah is saying here that everything has needs except me. Everything requires nourishment except me. Everything needs to be fed except me. Everything is utterly dependent other than me. وَهُوَ يُطْعِمُ وَلَا يُطْعَمُ. If you go to Surah Al-Dhariyat, and this is also a reminder that if something is dependent on another entity, that means it's not worthy of worship. It's not worthy of being your wali, your true wali, your absolute wali. The one who is your true caretaker and your true provider is the one who doesn't need to be provided for. This is what the Holy Prophet is trying to make these mushrikeen understand, that you're offering me money, You're making an offer to be my wali, to be my caretaker and my provider. I have a caretaker, I have a wali who doesn't need to be provided for, who doesn't need protection, who doesn't need to be maintained. Rather, He is the one who maintains, He is the one who nurtures, He is the one who provides. If you go to Surah Al-Dhariyat, Surah 51, verses 56 to 57. And as I mentioned, brothers and sisters, it's important to cross-reference when we study the Qur'an, because there are similar ayat throughout the Qur'an. So if you're able to make a note of these verses. Allah in Surah Al-Dhariyat, He says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have not created mankind and jinn except for the sole purpose that they worship me, that they obey me, that they submit to me. Now, the first thought that may come to mind when you think of a being who is asking you to worship him, you may think that he's asking us to worship him because he's a beneficiary. He's gaining something. Allah, in the next ayah, he says what? مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ مِنْ رِزْقٍ. I don't want any rizq from you. I don't want anything from you. وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ يُطْعِمُونَ. And I don't want them to feed me. I don't need them to provide for me. Meaning the message here is that when you worship me, you are the sole beneficiary. Allah says, I don't need your worship. I don't need your maintenance or your support. I don't need you to provide for me. Allah is saying, I'm the one who provides for you. Continuing the ayah, قُلْ of Surah Al-An'am, ayah 14, قُلْ, say, O Muhammad, إِنِّي أَنْ أَكُونَ أَوَّلَ مَنْ أَسْلَمْ وَلَا تَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to the Holy Prophet, say, O Muhammad, I was commanded to be the first of those who submit. Now, why is it important that the Holy Prophet makes this statement, that I am commanded to be the first one to submit? Brothers and sisters, the Holy Prophet is a leader of this religious movement. And one of the most important principles of leadership is what? You have to lead by example. Rasulullah's job is not just to preach. The Holy Prophet's job is to be the first one to practice what he preaches. That's why you find that sometimes you're sitting with certain scholars. When they speak to you, their words have an effect on you. You know why that is? Because the words of someone who practices what they preach has more of an impact on someone who talks without practicing what they preach. So here, it's important for the Holy Prophet to establish that I'm not inviting you towards something that I'm not myself practicing. Everything that I'm asking you to do, I'm the first one who does it. Everything that I'm asking you to refrain from, to abstain from, I'm the first one to abstain from it. Amir al-Mu'mineen, salawatullahi alayhi, he says, I have never asked you, he's speaking to the Muslim community, he says, I have never asked you to perform an action unless I was the first one to perform it. And I have never asked you to abstain from an action unless I was the first one to abstain from it. So the Holy Prophet is essentially saying that I lead by example. I am the first one to submit. قُلْ إِنِّي أُمِرْتُ أَنْ أَكُونَ أَوَّلَ مَنْ أَسْلَمْ. So this ayah may indicate that he was the first among the people of his time to submit to God, or he's the first one in rank, meaning that in عَالَمُ الدَّارِ, in the world of spirits, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked his creation, أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ, am I not your Lord? When he asked for this acknowledgement from his creation that he is the Lord of the world, the Holy Prophet was the first. He was the first one to respond by saying, na'am, yes, O my Lord, you are indeed my Lord. Now, the ayah ends with Allah telling the Holy Prophet, وَلَا تَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ, and do not be among the polytheists. Brothers and sisters, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi in Mecca, he's a monotheist, and his followers are monotheists, and they are the minority, which means the majority of the residents of Mecca are mushrikeen. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi could have lived a very comfortable life if he said, okay, I accept these idols. He could have earned wealth. They offered him the most beautiful of women. They offered him power. He could have, you know, as the saying goes, go along to get along. Rasulullah could have said, you know what, why should I bother myself with all of these hardships? I'll be among them. and I'll live a comfortable life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the Holy Prophet that even though joining them and being one of them would be easier, in the long run you'll pay the price. وَلَا تَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. And this is a lesson for us, my dear brothers and sisters. Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, he says, do not abandon the path of truth because of the scarcity of its followers. Ayah number 15. قُلْ إِنِّي أَخَافُ إِنْ عَصَيْتُ رَبِّي عَذَابَ يَوْمٍ عَظِيمٍ. Say, O Muhammad, that I fear if I disobey my Lord, I fear a severe, the punishment of a severe day. قُلْ إِنِّي أَخَافُ إِنْ عَصَيْتُ رَبِّي عَذَابَ يَوْمٍ عَظِيمٍ. Now we know the Holy Prophet is ma'soom. We know that he doesn't disobey. But here the Holy Prophet is trying to highlight a very important point. And that is, even if I were to disobey, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would punish me on the Day of Judgment. Meaning that Allah doesn't have a special relationship with anyone. The relationship that we have with Allah is the relationship of an abd to his mawla. It's narrated that Imam Zainul Abideen alayhi salam was in Masjid al-Haram one day, and he was supplicating in the darkness of the night. And one of the companions of Imam Zainul Abideen alayhi salam was listening from afar. It was dark, and he was listening to this supplication. He wasn't aware that this was Imam Zainul Abideen. So he approaches, he hears sobbing and crying. He approaches the Kaaba with his lantern, and he sees that it's Imam Zainul Abideen supplicating and imploring and beseeching Allah in the darkness of the night. And the man was shocked. He was puzzled. He says to the Imam, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, this is you who is crying at night, who's imploring Allah, who's begging Allah for forgiveness. Your grandfather is Rasulullah. Your grandmother is Lady Fatima. Your forefathers are Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, Imam al-Husayn. You have nothing to worry about. You come from the Ahlul Bayt. You come from a noble family. Imam Zainul Abideen alayhi salam, he says to him, Da'ni an dhikri jaddi wa abi. He says, don't speak to me about my father and my grandfather. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلْ خَلَقَ الْجَنَّةَ لِمَنْ أَطَاعَ وَلَوْ كَانَ عَبْدًا حَبَشِيًّا. He says, don't speak to me about my forefathers. For indeed Allah has created paradise for his obedient servant, even if he's an Ethiopian slave. Meaning, even if he's someone who's seen as a second-class citizen in this life, if he's obedient to Allah, Allah will honor him in the hereafter. وَخَلَقَ النَّارَ لِمَنْ عَصَاهُ وَلَوْ كَانَ سَيِّدًا قُرَشِيًّا. The Imam says, and Allah has created the hellfire for his disobedient servants, even if they're from the same family as the Prophet, even if they're from the same tribe as the Prophet. So the Imam alayhi salam, he's reminding this man that my distinction doesn't come from the fact that I have a noble lineage, I have noble ancestry. Rather, it's my amal, it's my actions that will make me either honorable on the Day of Judgment or among those who will be humiliated. So this is a general principle in the Quran. If you defy Allah, you will be held responsible, irrespective of your family relations, irrespective of the fact that you're related to the Prophet or not. Now you find that the Day of Judgment here is referred to as عذاب يوم عظيم, يوم عظيم, a great day. Brothers and sisters, if you look at the Quran, you find that it seems that all of the holy prophets, all of the prophets of Allah, all of the messengers, they used to lose a lot of sleep out of concern of the Day of Qiyamah. If you look at the supplications of Anbiya, of our Imams, there is a lot of anxiety and worry about the Day of Judgment. Now you may say, why is that? There's a wasiyah of the Holy Prophet that he gave to Abu Dhar. There's a hadith that says Abu Dhar al-Ghifari, the noble companion of the Holy Prophet, he says, one day I entered the masjid of the Holy Prophet in Medina, and I saw Rasulullah and Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam sitting together alone. And usually, Abu Dhar says, usually the Holy Prophet is surrounded by his companions, so I don't get, you know, one-on-one time with the Prophet. So I saw Rasulullah sitting with Amir al-Mu'mineen, so I thought to myself, this is a good opportunity to sit with Rasulullah and speak to him and get some advice from him. So Abu Dhar, he goes and he sits beside Amir al-Mu'mineen in the presence of the Prophet. He has a private audience with Rasulullah. So Abu Dhar says, Ya Rasulullah, teach me something that will benefit me in this dunya and in the akhirah. Give me some advice. And the Holy Prophet gives him advice. It's a long wasiyah, but I want to share with you one of the things that the Holy Prophet says to Abu Dhar with respect to the day of Qiyamah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi says, Ya Abu Dhar, لو أن رجلا كان له كعمل سبعين نبيا لاحتقره وخشي أن لا ينجو من شر يوم القيامة. It's an amazing hadith, brothers and sisters. Rasulullah says to Abu Dhar, Oh Abu Dhar, if a person were to have the good deeds of 70 prophets, he will find those good deeds to be very minimal, and he will fear that he may not attain salvation on the day of Qiyamah. Allahu Akbar. Imagine. Rasulullah says, even if you had the hasanat of 70 prophets, you will still have some anxiety on the day of Qiyamah. You're still going to have some concern. If you go to Surah Al-Hajj, Surah number 22, Ayah number 2, a description is given about the Day of Judgment, about the psychological state of people on the Day of Judgment. Ayah number 2, Surah 22. يوم ترونها تذهل كل مرضعة عما أرضعت. On that day, the mother that is nursing her child will drop her child. Imagine how much fear has to overcome a mother that she throws down and she abandons her own child, which is worth more than anything to her. Have you seen a mother when she holds her child? Nothing can make her lose grip of her child. But that day is so difficult, and the scenes of that day are so overwhelming that the mother who's nursing her child will forget about her child. وَتَضَعُ كُلُّ ذَاتِ حَمْلٍ حَمْلَهَا. And the mothers will miscarry their children because of the difficulties of that day. وَتَرَى النَّاسَ سُكَارَى. You will see that on the Day of Judgment, people will seem to be intoxicated. They will be very disoriented. وَمَا هُمْ بِسُكَارَى. You will think that they're drunk. Allah says, you will see people appearing intoxicated on the Day of Judgment, but they're not intoxicated. What's the matter with them? وَلَكِنَّ عَذَابَ اللَّهِ شَدِيدٌ. The punishment, the horrors and the terrors of that day are overwhelming. In the next ayah, ayah number 16, مَنْ يُصْرَفْ عَنْهُ يَوْمَئِذٍ فَقَدْ رَحِمَ وَذَٰلِكَ الْفَوْزُ الْمُبِينَ. Whosoever is spared on that day, on the Day of Judgment, he has certainly been merciful unto him. Meaning Allah has shown that person a great deal of mercy. And that is the manifest triumph. Brothers and sisters, no one enters Jannah because of their amal. We all enter paradise solely because of the mercy of Allah. Meaning, no one is entitled to enter paradise. Now you may say, even prophets? Yes, even prophets, even Rasulullah. There's a hadith from the Holy Prophet where Rasulullah says, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدٍ. I swear by the one whose who has my soul in his control. He's swearing by Allah. مَا مِنَ النَّاسِ أَحَدٌ يَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةِ بِعَمِلِ Rasulullah says, there is no one who will enter Jannah because they're worthy of it, because of their good deeds. قَالُوا وَلَا أَنْتَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ The companions of the Holy Prophet, they say, Ya Rasulullah, even you, you're not going to enter Jannah because of your good deeds? The Prophet says, وَلَا أَنَا إِلَّا أَن يَتَغَمَّدَنِيَ اللَّهُ بِرَحْمَتِهِ The Prophet says, even me, I will not enter Jannah because of my good deeds, because I'm entitled to enter paradise. Rather, I will enter paradise because of Allah's mercy. Because of Allah's mercy. Imam Zainul Abidin, if you think of glorifying Allah, you may think that, but I do dhikr of Allah, I glorify Him. Am I not deserving of reward? No, you're not deserving of reward. Imam Zainul Abidin, he says in his munajat, فَكَيْفَ لِي بِتَحْصِيلِ الشُّكْرِ Oh Allah, how can I thank you? فَكَيْفَ لِي بِتَحْصِيلِ الشُّكْرِ فَكُلَّمَا قُلْتُ لَكَ الْحَمْدِ وَجَبَ عَلَيَّ لِذَٰلِكَ أَنْ أَقُولَ لَكَ الْحَمْدِ Oh Allah, how can I thank you when thanking you is one of your blessings? Whenever I glorify you and praise you, I have to praise you for praising you because you're the one who gave me a tongue to praise you. You are the one who gave me a mind. You are the one who guided me and taught me the proper etiquette to praise you. You are the one who gave me the power and the ability to praise you. So every time I thank you and I praise you, I have to praise you for praising me. There's a beautiful story where there was an alim, a scholar, who was reading a dua that says, Allahumma amilni bi rahmatik wa la tu'amilni bi adlik. The dua, the line of dua said, Oh Allah, judge me by your mercy, not by your justice. Allahumma amilni bi rahmatik wa la tu'amilni bi adlik. Don't judge me, don't take me account according to your strict justice. Rather, deal with me mercifully. So this alim thought to himself that I've done a lot of good in my life. I have so many good deeds that I don't need Allah to be lenient with me. Allah can be strictly just with me and I would still qualify to enter paradise. So he flipped the dua. Instead of reciting Allahumma amilni bi rahmatik wa la tu'amilni bi adlik, he flipped the dua. He says, Allahumma amilni bi adlik wa la tu'amilni bi rahmatik. Oh Allah, take me to account by your justice and do not take me to account through your mercy. So he recited this dua. He was very confident in his good deeds and in his righteous actions. That night, he was reading and he had a candle and there was a fly, a house fly that was flying around and it kept on landing on his face. It was irritating him. So he took his pen and he stabbed it. It seems like he was very quick. He was able to kill the fly. He took the fly and he roasted it over the candle. This fly probably was really bothering him, irritating him. He decided to kill it and to roast it over the candle. So fly, he didn't think it was a big deal. That night he went to sleep. And he has a dream that it's the day of Qiyamah. He's confident that he has Salatul Layl, he's done all of his wajibat, he's avoided the muharramat, he's done all of these mustahabbat. So he's standing, awaiting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to judge him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you have many good deeds, but there is a mosquito, there's a fly that wants revenge, that wants me to seek retribution. You killed this fly and you roasted its body over an open flame. Now the same thing has to be done to you. That we have to insert something in you and we have to roast you over an open flame. The alim, he woke up and he immediately said, Allahumma amilni bi rahmatik wa la tu'amilni bi adlik. Oh Allah, judge me by your mercy, not by your justice. So my dear brothers and sisters, as the ayah says, whoever is spared on that day, indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has shown that person a great deal of mercy. If you go to Surah Ali Imran, Surah number 3, ayah 185, Allah says, فَمَنْ زُحْزِحَ عَنِ النَّارِ, the one who is removed from the hellfire, وَأُدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةِ, and who is made to enter paradise, فَقَدْ فَازَ, indeed that person is victorious. So forget about going to the upper levels of Jannah. If you're able to protect yourself from Jahannam, this is a huge success. فَمَنْ زُحْزِحَ عَنِ النَّارِ وَأُدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةِ فَقَدْ فَازَ. The next ayah. وَإِن يَمْسَسْكَ اللَّهُ بِضُرٍ فَلَا كَاشِفَ لَهُ. If Allah should touch you with affliction, none can remove it except Him. وَإِن يَمْسَسْكَ اللَّهُ بِضُرٍ فَلَا كَاشِفَ لَهُ إِلَّا هُوَ وَإِنْ يَمْسَسْكَ بِخَيْرٍ فَهُوَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. And should He touch you with goodness, then He is powerful over all things. Here, Allah is addressing the Holy Prophet. Now keep in mind, this surah is revealed during the late Meccan period. The Holy Prophet has experienced a lot of pain. He suffered tremendously. Here, Allah is reminding the Prophet, don't think that anything can happen to you, whether it's good or bad, unless it's through my permission. Meaning there is no affliction that reaches you unless there is divine permission. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding the Prophet that I am always in control. Nothing will happen to you unless I decree it. And no, if I decree that you will be afflicted, there is no one who can ward it off. The Holy Prophet was driven out of Mecca. This is a difficulty. This is something that had to happen. Meaning nothing could have reversed this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed that this is an affliction that has to take place. And any goodness, Rasulullah finds a safe haven in Mecca and Yathrib. When Allah wants to show you goodness, when He wants to give you a way out, there is no one that can block off that goodness. وَإِن يَمْسَسْكَ اللَّهُ بِضُرٍّ فَلَا كَاشِفَ لَهُ إِلَّا هُوَ وَإِن يَمْسَسْكَ بِخَيْرٍ فَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. And you know what comes to mind when I read this is Nabi Yusuf alayhi salam. The brothers of Yusuf tried to eliminate him. They threw him in a well. They thought he was history. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took him out of that well, and he made history. So there is no affliction that can reach you unless it is decreed by Allah. And there is no goodness that can reach you unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees. If God should touch you with affliction, none can remove it except Him. And should He touch you with goodness, then He is powerful over all things. So although this ayah is addressing specifically the Holy Prophet, it has a more general application. It affirms that Allah alone has power over all benefit or harm that may come to a human being, and none can alter the benefits or harm that He may decree for that person. And then if you go to the final ayah that we'll cover today because of the time, وَهُوَ الْقَاهِرُ فَوْقَ عِبَادِهِ وَهُوَ الْحَكِيمُ الْخَبِيرُ. And He is the dominant one over His servants, and indeed He is the all-wise and the one who is acquainted with all things. The word qahir is similar to the word ghalib. So you have qahara and you have ghalaba. In most cases, they're treated as synonyms. The one who overwhelms, ghalib, the one who is victorious. The difference between ghalaba and qahra is the following. Ghalaba means to overcome, but it can mean that this So you have Ghalib and you have Maghloob. And then you have Qahir and you have Maqhur. Ghalaba refers to overcoming your opposition, but it doesn't negate the fact that your opposition may have put up a fight. So for example, there's a battle and one army is Ghalib and the other army is Maghloob. The army that's Maghloob may have put up a fight, but the other army was victorious. They overcame, they overwhelmed. But Qahir means that you dominate the opposition in such a way that they were not even able to put up a fight. As we recite in Dua al-Iftitah, قَهَرَ بِعِزَّتِهِ الْأَعْزَاءِ. When Allah overwhelms, when He exercises His power, the opposition, the one who is whom He is overwhelming, doesn't even have the ability to put up a fight. وَهُوَ الْقَاهِرُ فَوْقَ عِبَادِهِ. He's above His servants. Now here, above obviously doesn't mean physically above, that He's above them in the sense that He has full power over them. وَهُوَ الْحَكِيمُ الْخَبِيرُ. It's interesting that Allah's attribute of hikmah is used alongside His attribute of being qahir. Usually, when governments or when individuals have tremendous power, what happens? Absolute power corrupts absolutely. They become reckless. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that I'm qahir, I'm all powerful, I dominate, I overwhelm, but I'm not reckless. Meaning, when I overwhelm my enemies, those who stand in opposition to me, I do it with hikmah. Meaning, I know who to overpower, and I know when to do it. I know who to dominate and when to dominate. وَهُوَ الْقَاهِرُ فَوْقَ عِبَادِي وَهُوَ الْحَكِيمُ الْخَبِيرُ. There's hikmah behind the way that Allah exercises His power. There's wisdom in the way that Allah exacts punishment upon His enemies. وَهُوَ الْحَكِيمُ الْخَبِيرُ. And He's well acquainted. You know, have you seen, there are certain governments that when they attack the enemy, they kill indiscriminately. They drop bombs and they don't know who they're dropping bombs on. When Allah says He's khabir, He's well acquainted with who's receiving the punishment. So the punishment, the power is coupled with wisdom. And the opposition, the enemies, those who are receiving the punishment, Allah knows them very well. They're deserving of it. He's khabir. He knows who is deserving of this punishment. Inshallah, the next verses require a bit of time to cover. So I think we'll stop here and we'll leave some time for questions and answers. Wa sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa alihi al-tahirin.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaykum assalam wa rahmatullah. Can you please speak up so I can hear you?
Yes. Right, Islam. So you talked about fadara. So yeah. Does fadara have a similar meaning as falak? Because they both sound like they talk about splitting.
They're similar to each other, definitely. Falaqa, yeah, and in fact, if you look at, you know, Arabic dictionaries, you'll find that it's listed among, if you look at fatara, you'll see shaqqa, falaqa. These are considered synonyms.
Thank you very much, Sheikh.
Inshallah. Please keep me in your dua, and inshallah, we'll resume with the tafsir next week, inshallah. As-salamu alaykum ad-du'a, inshallah. As-salamu alaykum.